Is this the day the Lord has made? What are you going to do about it? Rejoice and be glad in it. Amen. If you're joining us by Ustream this morning, rejoice and be glad. Hallelujah. We thank you. Father, we come before you this morning. We thank you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you have given us the word, not just to educate us, but to bring forth the spiritual food within our lives and bringing forth that substance of faith that causes us to rise above the ordinary, that causes us to walk as spiritual people. Lord, I thank you as the word comes forth this morning. You said in your word that your word is spirit and your word is life. I thank you, Lord, that the people here this morning and those that are hearing these words will receive the word in the spirit this morning. I thank you also for the life that comes from this word, that it cancels out all death that may be active in our life. I thank you, Lord, you said you sent your word and it doesn't return void, but it accomplishes in the things you send it to. And not only does it accomplish, you said it also prospers in that. So, Father, I thank you for the spiritual prosperity that comes from this word this morning. Lord, I ask that your blessing be upon it in Jesus' name. If you agree this morning, shout amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Are you excited this morning?
Amen.
If you're excited, shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. We're going to continue picking up what we started 2 weeks ago. How many know what we started speaking on 2 weeks ago? How many? One person. Hallelujah. Thank you, Melissa. How to grow spiritually. We know how to grow naturally, don't we? Right? We know that we have to feed our face in order to grow naturally. The medical world says, the FDA says, now that we should be eating 5 to 6 meals a day. And that we should have 9 servings of fruits and vegetables every day if we want to live a healthy life. Amen? Turn to neighbor and say, that's a lot of stuffing of your face. Amen? And last week we mentioned that spiritual growth is not much different than natural growth. That it requires for us to feed on something. It requires for us to put something in, or else we don't grow. And the whole point of being a child of God is that we grow up into being who God said we should be. Turn to your neighbor and say, it's about time you become who God said you are. Amen. Just a quick review on the opening foundational text. We started reading in 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 1 in the voice. And it says, so get rid of hatefulness and deception, of insincerity and jealousy and slander. Be like newborn babies. Turn to your neighbor and say, he's talking about you. Crying out for spiritual milk that will help you grow into salvation. Now, he's writing this to people that are already saved. But he said, you need to desire the milk so you can grow into salvation. You see, there's more than one aspect of salvation. When we get saved, we know we are transformed from a sinner into a saint. We know our permanent address changes from hell to heaven, right? But God wants us to grow into the fullness of what salvation is. Salvation is more than a free ticket to heaven. Can you say amen?
Amen?
Salvation is able to live in the peace and the prosperity that God promised us in the Word of God. It is living in the place of health, not being bound up with sickness or disease. It's not living a life of poverty. So salvation is more than just going to heaven. Salvation is about your well-being here on earth. And the Word of God says we need to grow into it.
Amen?
Amen. How many of you have children? More than one child. You know, the first child is always the best child, they say, because he always gets the best of everything. The second child ends up getting the hand-me-downs. And a lot of times the second child has to grow into those hand-me-downs. That child might be a size 3, but the clothes are a size 5. So they're hanging off past his arms, but eventually one day he will grow into that. We need to grow in to our salvation. Can you say, I'm growing?
I'm growing.
I'm growing and you knowing. Amen. Hallelujah. To help you grow into salvation. Verse 3, if you've tasted and found the Lord to be good. Now listen, if you've tasted, you have found the Lord is good. If you have tasted and found that the Lord's not good, you tasted the wrong Lord.
Amen.
Pretty simple, right? A lot of people serve all the wrong things. And sad to say, most people serve themselves. Continue. Come to him, the living stone, who was rejected by people but accepted by God as chosen and precious. Like living stones, let yourself be assembled into a spiritual house, a holy order of priests who offer up spiritual sacrifices that will be acceptable to God through Jesus the Anointed. Amen? So as newborn babies, we are to desire the pure milk of the Word. How many of you have desires? Most of you don't have desire. Well, I think we just found the problem. We should desire everything that God has for us. Amen? The word desire means to dote upon. It means to intensely crave possession. You ever have a craving for something? And no matter what you do, the craving doesn't go away until you get what you're craving. Amen? We are to crave the Word. Have you had cravings for Deuteronomy lately? Oh, I'm just craving Leviticus. Not so much, huh? Begat, 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 begit, begat, begat. That's Chrono, that's Numbers, the utensil, right. Amen? But we should desire the pure milk of the Word so that we may grow. Turn to your neighbor and say, grow.
Grow.
Grow. We're growing up. We're growing up. How many of you want to grow up?
Amen.
I want to grow up. I don't want to be always like Peter Pan. I won't grow up. I want to grow up, but I don't want to grow old.
Amen.
I want to grow up, but I don't want to grow old. Now, that's not a knock against people who are older than myself. There are a lot of young people that are in their 70s and 80s.
Amen?
Amen? By growing old, I don't want to be one of these people that always has this look on their face, always yelling at the kids in the neighborhood, get off my lawn! I don't want to be grumpy. I don't want to grow old and cranky. I want to grow up. How many want to grow up with me?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. The word grow means to enlarge. And it's funny because the word for prosperity means to enlarge. I want to grow. I want to prosper in this life, not just financially. I want to prosper in my body. I want to prosper in my health. I want to prosper in my relationships. I want to prosper in my calling.
Amen.
How about you?
I
want to prosper in the things that God has called me to do. How about you? Do you want me to prosper in the things God has called me to do?
Amen.
Just like I want you to prosper in the things God called you to do.
Amen?
Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. The expanded Bible says, so then rid yourselves of all evil, all lying and deceit, hypocrisy, jealousy, envy, and evil speech. Uh-oh. Slander, all traits that destroy relationships. As newborn babes want milk, you should want the pure, sincere, unadulterated, and simple but spiritual teaching. Milk, probably referring to the Word of God here. By it you can mature, grow, reach maturity in your salvation because you have already examined and seen and tasted how good the Lord is. You see, there's nothing more sad than a Christian who doesn't act like a Christian. There's nothing that is more distasteful to the world than a Christian who has not grown up. Amen. Now listen, when you first gave your life to the Lord, when you first got born again, when you first got saved, lots of zeal and excitement, no knowledge, you know, kind of like Joseph did with his brothers, you know, young man, zeal. God said, I'm going to rule and reign over you guys. You know, he didn't really have to tell them that, did he? You know, so sometimes when we're young and kind of inexperienced, we kind of do things or say things that aren't exactly mature. We have to make sure that we're growing and we're not repeating the sins of our past. If you constantly repeat the same attitudes, the same sins, constantly have to be corrected the same word verbatim for 5 years, something wrong. You're not growing. Right? And we hear the excuses all the time as leaders and pastors, we hear it, especially when people come that are new. You know, well, how come you left your church? Well, I wasn't growing. I wasn't being fed. It's not the pastor's job to grow you. It's the pastor's job to impart into you. It's your responsibility to grow. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. All throughout the body of Christ, there's plenty of marketing schemes on how to grow your church. There's only one way. Obey. Obey the teaching and you'll grow. Obey your leaders and you'll grow. Obey the word and you'll grow. Because you will be planting the seeds, the incorruptible seeds that can't die, into your heart and your mind. And those incorruptible seeds planted with a right attitude on a right heart are guaranteed to produce fruit. Amen. Turn to David and say, produce some fruit. Amen. Amen. Is it cold in here? No. Yep. Good. I'm leaving it. 2 Peter. Turn to 2 Peter. Second Peter chapter 1. When you get there, say amen. It's right before, right after 1 Peter. Right, right. I messed up my own joke. Okay. You there? In the Amplified Bible, 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 3 to 10 in the Amplified Bible. It says, for his divine power has bestowed upon us absolutely everything necessary, a dynamic, spiritual life and godliness, through true and personal knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and excellence. Stop. It says here that his divine power was bestowed absolutely upon us, giving us everything necessary for a dynamic spiritual life. Say dynamic.
Dynamic.
Dynamic spiritual life. Turn to your neighbor and say, is your spiritual life dynamic? Well, if you're not sure what the word dynamic means, the best way of understanding dynamic is understanding what the opposite of dynamic is. The opposite of dynamic is half-hearted, dull, fruitless, impotent, and wishy-washy. God hasn't called you to a wishy-washy spiritual faith. God hasn't called you to a fruitless spiritual life. That's not what God has called you. He has called you to have a dynamic, an exciting, a fruitful, a powerful, a life-changing, life-giving spiritual life. That's what God has called you. He said he has furnished us everything we need to have a dynamic spiritual life. Turn to your neighbor and say, dynamic.
Amen?
Amen? A dynamic spiritual life and godliness through true personal knowledge of him, through true personal knowing of him, through a true personal intimacy with God. So one of the ways that we grow is by the word of God, right? The problem is with many believers today is this is just knowledge stored up in their heads. They don't become intimately acquainted with the Holy Spirit who wrote it and teaches it. Their relationship with God lacks, and they become word nerds. They have head knowledge that puffs up. It puffs up. It doesn't humble. It makes you proud. Because you can quote all the scriptures with perfect eloquence, but you can't live a lick of it. Because it hasn't gotten from your head to your heart. Amen? So we need to develop this dynamic spiritual life that God has already made available to you. Already gave it to you. It's there on a silver platter for the taking. We must choose to receive it. Amen? Hallelujah. Through true personal knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and excellence. You see how God is excellent. And if He's excellent, guess what we're supposed to be? Wishy-washy, dull, impotent. No, we're supposed to be excellent as well. Excellence begets excellence. Can you say hallelujah?
Hallelujah.
For by these He has bestowed upon us His precious and magnificent promises of inexpressible value, so that by them you may escape from the immoral freedom that is in the world because of disreputable desires. Now let me ask you a question. Is there an outlandish, outrageous amount of freedom for sin in this country these days? Where Isaiah says, you know, good would be called evil and evil would be called good. Amen. Do we see this right before our very eyes? For crying out loud, we don't even know what bathroom to use. Amen. That we would escape. You see, when we become intimately acquainted with God and we start moving in this dynamic spiritual life, we will be able to keep ourselves separated from the pull and the control of this evil times that we live in. Amen. Well, aren't you supposed to love everyone? I do love everyone, and we are supposed to love everyone. We're not supposed to love the sin or the deception. We're supposed to love the people who are blinded from truth and are deceived. You know, we're not picking on people. You know, you're against homosexuals. No, we're not. We're against homosexuality. And there's a big difference. I'm not against bank robbers. I'm against bank robbery. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. Especially when they're trying to rob my money. Amen? So by them you may escape from the immoral freedom that is in this world because of this reputable desire and become sharers of the divine nature. Now thank God when we got saved, we become sharers of His divine nature, right? We are partaking in God's divine nature. We no longer have that sinful nature. We partake in the divine nature. But that sinful nature still wants to creep up. And our unregenerated, unrenewed mind still wants to control. Amen? For this very reason, applying your diligence, say diligence. Diligence is one of them action words. Diligence is one of those words that can mean hard work. Diligence to the divine promise, make every effort in exercising your faith to develop moral excellence. And in moral excellence, knowledge, insight, understanding, also in the personal knowing, and in your knowledge, self-control, and in your self-control, steadfastness, and in your steadfastness, godliness, and in your godliness, brotherly affection, and in your brotherly affection, develop Christian love. That is, learn to unselfishly seek the best for others and do things for their benefit. That was a mouthful. Amen. Go home and get your Amplified Bible and teach it to yourself. For these qualities are yours and they are increasing. You see, when we are pressing into God, when we're desiring the sincere milk of the Word, where we are desiring God's Word, God's truth, God's power, God's faith over the status quo, we begin to change. And it's from like glory to glory to glory to glory. It's from one stage of growth to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. For as these qualities are yours and are increasing in you as you grow towards spiritual maturity, they will keep you from being useless and unproductive or not dynamic. In regard to the true knowledge and the greater understanding of our Lord Jesus Christ, for whoever lacks these qualities is blind, short-sighted, closing his spiritual eyes to the truth. You know, there's a lot of people that close their eyes to the spiritual truths of the Bible. There's a lot of people that stuff up their spiritual ears and say, I don't want to hear that. I don't want to hear that. Don't tell me that. I don't want to hear that. Because if I hear that, I have to be responsible to that. So I want to plead ignorance before the throne of God when I'm judged. I never heard that. You lie. Because in this church, you're going to hear it. Amen? Hallelujah. Isn't this a wonderful word? They will keep you from being useless. Say useless. And unproductive. Say unproductive. You know, each and every one of you have been called to this house for a purpose. Each and every one of you have been called into the kingdom of God for a purpose. It is to minister to the lost. It's to love the hurting, right? It's to go into the highways and the byways and minister to them and to bring them in, right? Ask yourself, am I useless? How do you know if you're useless? How do you know if you're wishy-washy? How do you know if you're not walking in the dynamic spiritual life that God has already given you? Well, if you're not bearing fruit, you're not reproducing and bringing others to God, there's an issue. Right? If you're not amping up your love deliberately and watching your mouth and not getting angry, you're living way beneath what God has already given you. That's why we need to grow. Amen? Ready? For whoever lacks these qualities is blind, short-sighted, closing his spiritual eyes to the truth, having become oblivious to the fact that he was cleansed from his old sins. You see, what happens in our spiritual life is when we resist the Holy Spirit, we start to become dull to his convictions. When we get dull to the convictions or the voice of the Holy Spirit, we're in trouble. Because we have chosen to quench the Spirit in our own life. So when we're not being led by the Spirit, say, led by the Spirit,
led by the Spirit.
You're fruitless. You're fruitless. Because the Spirit in the nature of God is to reproduce. The Spirit in the nature of God is to reproduce. If you're fruitless, your spiritual dynamics are lacking. So if your spiritual dynamics are lacking, we need to amp it up a little bit, and we need to grow into this maturity that we're talking about. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Therefore, believers, be all the more diligent to make certain about his calling and the reason he chose you. Be sure that your behavior reflects and confirms your relationship with God. For by doing these things, actively developing these virtues, you will never stumble in your spiritual growth, and you will live a life that leads others away from sin. That's powerful stuff. That's powerful stuff. Amen? How many of you want this? You streamers, you want this? Send me an email and say, I want this. Amen? Now, I just want to back up to verse 5 a second. It says, for this very reason, applying your diligence to the divine promise, make every effort in exercising your faith. Say exercise.
Exercise.
That's not exercising demons. It's exercising your faith. We have to exercise our faith. Amen?
Amen.
Exercise. For some people, that's a curse word. How dare you insult me? Telling me I need to exercise. Yeah, you do. Amen? 1 Timothy chapter 4. When you get there, say amen. God is good, isn't he? That he loves us so much that he gives us the insights in his word on how to be where God wants us to be. Turn to your neighbor and say, wishy-washy no more. 1 Timothy 4, verse 4 to 10. You ready? In the Amplified Bible, it says, for everything God has created is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it's received with gratitude. For it is sanctified, set apart, and dedicated to God by means of the word of God and prayer. Okay? Verse 6. Now this is, understand, this is Paul teaching Timothy how to effectively pastor in his ministry, okay? If you point out these instructions to the brothers and sisters, say, point out these instructions. What instructions? You're about to get them. If you point out these instructions to the brothers and sisters, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus. Ready? Be constantly nourished through study on the words of the faith. Be constantly studied on the words of faith. Always building yourself up and nourishing yourself on the words of faith. Not just the word of God, but the word of God that's going to produce faith in your life. Amen? And of the good Christian doctrine, which you have already closely followed. So he's saying to Timothy, you know, teach them what you do. You're a good servant of God because you're studying the word of faith and you're demonstrating what it is to live a good Christian life, living the Christian doctrine. Amen? You with me? Okay. Be constantly nourished through study on the word of faith and the good Christian doctrine which you have closely followed. But, say but, have nothing to do with irreverent folklore and silly myths. Now, sometimes the body of Christ fills themselves up with things that they really shouldn't. Major distractions, conspiracy theories, who cares, it don't matter.
Well, George Bush took down the Twin Towers,
who cares, it don't matter. It's got nothing to do with your spiritual life. Amen? And trust me, there's 100 other folklores out there, okay? On the other hand, discipline yourself for the purpose of godliness, keeping yourself spiritually fit. On the other hand, discipline yourself. That word discipline yourself is exercise. How many of you here exercise on a daily basis? Can you raise your hands? Takes discipline, all four of you. It takes discipline, you know. There's nothing worse. I know it happens in my life. I get on the treadmill. I get into a good groove, you know. You know what I'm talking about? I got a nice long streak going. I'm on the treadmill, you know. I'm climbing mountains and everything else, you know. And then all of a sudden something will happen. I'll give you an example, you know, this nonsense cough that was going around, right? I got hit with that. I stopped the trip. Boy, it's so hard to get back on that thing. It is so hard. And it's sitting there in my office crying, use me. You know? It takes discipline. It takes diligence, right? Exercise for the purpose of godliness, keeping yourself spiritually fit. Verse 8. For physical training is of some value. Your Bible might say, bodily exercise profits little. It does have some profit. It profits little in comparison to exercising your spiritual life. Your natural exercise profits little. Now, that doesn't say don't exercise. The Bible's not saying, you know, we look for excuses not to do things. Oh, thou shalt not exercise. You see, it says thou shalt not. My name is there. Pastor Vin, get off the tread. It doesn't say that. Doesn't say that. It says it profits a little bit. All right? You'll get in shape. You might live a little longer on this earth. Right? But spiritual exercise is what this is all about. A spiritual routine. Spiritual diligence. Amen. Amen. It says, for physical training is of some value, but godliness, spiritual training, is of value in everything and in every way. Spiritual training is valuable in everything in your life and in every way in your life. It benefits every single area of your life. Doing the treadmill is not going to fix your rotted teeth. Right? It's not a cure-all for everything. Right? Spiritual exercise is a cure-all for everything. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And the people that are in the spirit are rejoicing, and the people that are in their flesh are giving me dirty looks right now. I'm getting that, what you talking about with this look? Amen? Hallelujah. It's value in everything and every way, since it holds promise for this present life and for the life to come. Amen? It holds promise for this life and the life to come. You see, natural exercise only profits in this life. It only profits in the now. It only profits in the limited time that we have on this earth. Natural exercise is fleshly and carnal. Let's face it, I didn't say it was sinful. Just because we hear the words fleshy and carnal, right away we think it's sin. It's natural. Spiritual exercise is eternal. And it comes to affect us in this life so we can live a life of victory, peace, prosperity, whatever it is. And it also carries over into eternity. Amen. Do you know that once we get to heaven, we're not just going to be sitting back on a beach sipping virgin Mai Tais? Did you know that? We will forever be learning still. Amen. 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 Just for the record, I've never had a Mai Tai in my life. I'm not even sure what it is, but I think it has an umbrella. I'm not sure. Hallelujah. Amen. This is a faithful and trustworthy saying, worthy of full acceptance and approval. In other words, God said, this is your guarantee in writing. And it's for your approval. In other words, I dare you, try it. You'll see, God's right. I'm always right. Right? God's always right. He just wants you to step out of your boat and walk on some water for a change instead of walking on people. Ooh. We tread on serpents and scorpions, not on the backs of our children or our parents or our neighbors, our enemies, our co-workers, whatever. Amen? Why are we so easily moved, people? Why are we so easily moved by the nonsense of people around us? You remember what I said 2 weeks ago? God has put people in your life to sharpen you. You know, you're praying that they get raptured. God says, I ain't taking them until you're complete. You have a lot of rough edges that need to come off you. Amen? How many of you like diamonds? There was this big diamond that just recently sold. I don't know how many carats. It's like $5.75 million for a rock. For a rock. Amen? But a diamond, every diamond starts off as coal. A piece of coal. You know, something that you would throw in a fireplace. But the only difference is it's coal that has come under intense pressure. So each and every one of you that are going through pressure, you're a diamond in the rough. Amen. The problem is, Sometimes we create our own pressure. And sometimes we create our own problems. And sometimes we don't obey the voice of the Lord. And sometimes we're led by something other than the voice of the Lord. Can I get amen?
Amen.
Turn to your neighbor and say, he knows what he's talking about. Sometimes, let's go to the extreme. Sometimes a religious spirit will get a hold of us and make us do things that makes us believe that we're pleasing God. And the religious spirit will always drive you to do things that seem spiritual that God hasn't called you to do. How do you know whether it's a religious spirit? Well, number one, is it bearing fruit? Is there fruit of change? Number two, are you growing in it? Are you becoming more like Jesus because of it? And number three, are you tired and sick because of it? You see, the Holy Spirit will gently lead us and guide us. He'll gently lead us to the place we need to be. And we need to not run ahead of the Holy Spirit. Because when we run ahead of the Holy Spirit, we're doing it in our own strength. And if we're doing it in our own strength, our body gets worn out. And if our body gets worn out, we get sick and we end up weak. And then the devil can kind of abuse us a little bit. Amen? We always need to make sure that what we're doing is led by the Spirit of God. Now, if we're not growing in God and we're not developing a relationship with the Holy Spirit, how will we ever know when he's leading us or telling us to stop? We'll be doing things just because we're pious and just because, you know, oh yeah, you know, I got to love this person. I don't want anyone to go to hell. Guess what? Jesus doesn't want anyone to go to hell. He wills zero to perish and all to come to salvation, right? That's his heart. But then it also says the road to destruction is very wide, right? But the path is narrow, which means more will be going down than up. Amen? So he desires none to perish, but there's going to be a lot perishing. Our job is to get people saved, right? Right? But we don't do the saving. Right? We don't do the saving. Jesus saves. Pastor Vin can't save a fly. Not what I want to. Oh, you know what? I was doing a study on, you know, the word Beelzebub. You know, one of the definitions of the word Beelzebub is Lord of the Flies. Remember that book?
Yeah.
But I was looking into the definition of the word Beelzebub. You know what else it says? The dung god. The dung god. Isn't that wonderful? So every time the devil is tormenting you, say, you little piece of dung. Amen? We need to make sure we're led by the Spirit, people. Okay? Exercise profits little, but spiritual exercise profits a lot. This is a faithful, trustworthy saying, worthy of full acceptance and approval. It is for this that we labor and strive, often called to account, because we have fixed our confident hope on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially to those who believe in him, recognize him as the Son of God, and accepts him as Savior and Lord. You see, he's the Savior of all people. 100% of the people, Jesus is their Savior. Whether they choose him or not is up to them, because he's given us free will to choose.
Amen?
Amen? So his heart is 100%, and he's the Savior for all people. But we know not everyone's going to be saved. It's sad. Right? Amen. The word exercise, check this word out. You ready? Now, I don't want you to get freaked out. Don't get freaked out. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't get freaked out. The word exercise in the Greek means to exercise naked. Don't get freaked out. Don't get freaked out. Right? We're not going to have a nude Bible study on Wednesdays, okay? I said we're not, okay? It means to train. It means to discipline or to be trained. It means that the Thayer says to exercise naked, to exercise vigorously in any way, either the body or the mind. Okay? Now, why exercise naked? Well, you have to put yourself in the mindset of the times. Remember back when the ancient Greeks started the Olympics? These guys would do this naked. And you know why they did it naked? Because they didn't want any restrictions or hindrances on their performance. They didn't want the clothes or the robes they wore. It's kind of hard to throw a discus in a robe. You know what I mean? Right? So everything that restricts you, take it off. Start exercising your faith naked. Unrestrained. Also, out there in the open. I hear crickets. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. We want to grow, right? Over the last couple years, I've planted 3 apple trees in my yard. I planted one in the backyard, one on one side and one on the other, because there needs to be a certain amount of distance so they can pollinate properly. And the first year, both trees grew, you know. And then the second year, the one tree started to wither and die. So I said, oh man, we spoke life to it, but it still died. So we plucked it out and we put a new one in. And that tree thrived for a year, but then that tree died. And so we had to make a determination. There was a couple things obviously going wrong. Now, when you plant a plant or you plant a tree that doesn't take, there could be 3 issues. Too much sun, not enough water. Too much water, not enough sun. Or the ground conditions are not right. Amen? Well, in our particular case, the problem was not enough sun, and I think the ground on that side is not as good as the other side. When I dig the hole on this side, I get sand and clay pretty quick. When I dig the hole on this side, it's that nice black topsoil. All right? Plus the sun. So, in our lives, we need to make sure we have a good balance. Right? We need to make sure that we're receiving enough from the sun and we're receiving enough of the water. Right? Now, the water in the Bible is representative of 2 different things. The Word of God is the water, but the water is also symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Okay? So we may have our salvation, but if we're not getting the Word or getting revelation or a relationship with the Holy Spirit, we will not grow and bear fruit. The other tree, it's a yellow delicious, produces apples already. We've had how many apples this past summer? I'm going to say maybe 15 apples. A lot of them fell on the ground. I think the landscaper picked a couple, but whatever. And you know what? They were good. They were tasty, right? The conditions on that side are perfect. Now, I just put another tree in, but I didn't put it on that side. I put it on this side. And one of the things that we have to do is we have to make sure we water it. But then we have to also do something else. And I'm going to sum it up with another story. Is that all right? I have a friend of mine who's a pastor in Brooklyn. He has a bunch of children. I think he's starting his own tribe. And so he put a post up on Facebook the other day, and he said, I went with the kids to Prospect Park. And we were walking through the park, and I came across a big pile of horse poop, horse manure. You know, they have the stables over there, right, in Prospect Park. So he got himself a plastic bag, and he picked up the poop and put it in the bag, and his kids were mortified. Dad, what are you, crazy? He says, no, I'm going to bring this home, and I'm going to put it on my tomato plants because I know that that manure is going to create better fruit. Amen? So we need the right amount of sun. We need the right amount of water, and we need the right amount of fertilizer. Dung. Right? The tribulations that we go through are producing life in us, the Bible says. You know, you want your Christian life to be nothing but roses and tweeting birds. You get that, but you also have to deal with the dung god. And everything he does in your life, please look at it as fertilizer. Now, there are things we can stop him from doing in our lives, but there are some things that are beyond our control, like the behavior of other people. Right? We can unfriend them on Facebook, but they'll still give you hell. They're really not your friend anyway, but you know, you understand? So there are some things that are beyond our control. You know, if you have a problem with being late, your boss might dock you. And you go, that miserable, no. You gave the dung god the right to torment you until you get your life right. Do you know that it's shameful? Say shameful. It's shameful for a Christian to live beneath excellence. It's shameful because it gives me a bad name and it gives each and every one of us a bad name in the eyes and the expectation of the world. We should be people that are never late anywhere. Amen? We went to a movie yesterday. The movie started at 2:45. We got there at 1:30. It wasn't worth it, by the way. It wasn't worth it. You know, we go to a Christian concert. We go to see Sight and Sound Theater. We go to these places of amusement and entertainment. And we don't want to miss it. We don't want to be late. But yet on our jobs or even church, there's no condemnation in Christ, but I'm speaking the truth in love. We need to be on time, people. We need to be on time. There are some people where things happen. I hit traffic. Okay, it happens. Sometimes, and Rosie will, because we come from the same exit. We come from 26B, right, on the Cross Island. Sometimes we'll come to church on a Sunday morning and find out it's Bicycle Sunday and the Cross Island closes at the Grand Central and we have to detour and it might make us late. It happens, right? Sometimes things happen. But if we are consistently late, not only do I think it's a little disrespectful to the house, I know that it's disrespectful to the Holy Spirit. I know it is. So these are areas where we need to make sure we are shoring up and tightening up in our lives because we suffer lack because of it. Amen? As Christians, we are always prepared. We are always to be prepared for the move of God. Right? My dad did a teaching some years ago, and it was called, "When One's Off Course, We All Suffer Loss." Right? That's when one person comes out of unity and agreement in action or even in belief. We are only as strong as the weakest link. And that's what he taught back then, you know. And we need to make sure, listen, sometimes things happen. It's impossible for things to happen every Sunday. I'm sorry, it's impossible unless you don't plan. Amen? Amen? This is one area we need to oh, it hurts. It hurts to get up 15 minutes earlier. Oh, I'm dying. That's the point. Die to yourself and live in the Spirit. Amen? Hallelujah. Last. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7 to 14. When you're there, say amen. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 7 to 14. It says, while Jesus lived on earth in the days of his flesh or earthly life. This is the expanded Bible, by the way. He prayed to God and asked God for help. He offered prayers and petitions. He prayed with loud cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. This is probably talking about the Garden of Gethsemane. And his prayer was heard because he trusted God of his reverence and devotion. Even though Jesus was the Son of God, or a son with all the rights and privileges of an heir, he learned obedience by what he suffered. You see, the trials in your life are there to get you to line up to God. Amen? I didn't get a big amen. Okay, I gotcha. Okay. He learned obedience by what he suffered. Through total obedience to God, Jesus achieved the glorified or perfected state God originally intended for all human beings, mankind. And because his obedience was perfect, or having achieved perfection, he was able to give, become the source, the means of eternal salvation to all who obey. In this way, God made, designated, and appointed Jesus a high priest, a priest like in the priestly order or the line of Melchizedek. We have much to say about this, but it's hard to explain to you because you are slow of understanding. You are hard of hearing spiritually. Okay? Now, if you understood everything I just said, doesn't apply to you. Okay? Verse 12, by now, you should be teachers, but you need someone to teach you again the first lessons, elementary truths, and basic principles of God's message, his revelation, or even oracles. You still need the teaching that is like milk. You're not ready for solid food. For anyone who lives on milk is still a baby and knows nothing about or is unskilled or inexperienced with right teaching or the message of righteousness. But solid food is for those who are grown up, mature, for they are mature enough, who through practice and through exercise have trained their faculties or their senses to know the difference between good and evil. You see, we should desire the milk of the word, but by now some of us have been on milk for 5 years. Some of us have been on milk for 8 years. Some of us have been on milk for 15 years. There's time. It's the time now for you to grow up and start really getting revelation from God. It's time for you to come out of the wishy-washy and into the dynamic. It's time for you to come out of the ordinary and into the superabundance of God's ability and grace. It's time for you to rise up into the calling that God has upon your life, because the days are short and the days are numbered, and you just sitting on a seat on a Sunday morning serves the kingdom of God absolutely no glory or honor. Amen. It is self-serving, if that. It is selfish. I receive. This was good. My head is swelled. Thank you. Can't live a lick of it because it's only milk. Rise up, people. Rise up. In closing, turn to 1 Corinthians. This is my second in closing, I know. 1 Corinthians 9:24. When you get there, say, I'm there. Wow, you're fast. 1 Corinthians 9:24-27 in the Amplified Bible, it says, do you not know that in the race all the runners run their very best to win, but only one receives the prize? Run your race in such a way that you may seize the prize and make it your own. Verse 25, now every athlete who goes into training, say exercise, and competes in the games, is disciplined and exercises self-control in all things. You need to learn to control self. You need to take this carnal, fleshy thing known as self and control it. I prefer to use duct tape on it. Right? Every athlete who goes into training, competes the games, is disciplined and exercises self-control in all things. They do it to win a crown that withers, right? In the Olympics, right? They didn't give them gold medals back in the days. They put a crown, a wreath on their head. Look, I'm the winner. And in 4 days, it was dead. Amen? Right? They do it to win a crown that withers, but we do it to receive an imperishable crown that cannot wither. Therefore, I do not run without a definite goal. I do not frail around like one beating the air, just shadow boxing. But like a boxer, I strictly discipline my body and make it my slave, so that after I have preached the gospel to others, I myself will not somehow be disqualified or seen unfit for service. Amen. Paul says, one translation says he beats himself into submission. Now, it's not a physical beating himself. He's not punching himself in the face. He's punching his flesh. He's punching and working out. You ever see a boxer? Oh, man, they're conditioned. They're conditioned, whether it's MMA or, you know, the old school boxing. These guys are conditioned, and they're conditioned to do one thing. You know what it is? To be beat up, but yet to win. They are conditioning themselves so they can withstand a beating. Let me ask you a question. Are you fortified that you could withstand the beating? Or as soon as something doesn't go your way, do you lay down and cry? Do you say, Jesus doesn't love me? Right? Last week I was talking about, you know, helping people. You know, give the example of trying to help someone save the marriage. This is what you need to do, you know. Go do this. Get this book. Read this. You know, start doing the things that you caused your wife to fall in love with you. You know, yeah, I'll do it. I'll do it. Do it. But 2 weeks later, I called my lawyer. I'm getting divorced. You know, people, this is a long marathon. And we need to press forward. And we need to press forward and not be so quick to give up. When it doesn't look like anything is happening, you got to change what you're looking at. Right? And look unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Look unto the Word, the one that produces that faith. Look unto what God is saying and not what your circumstance is saying. Put your hope in God. Amen? Put your hope in God. He loves you. He wants to see you prosper. He wants to give you that crown that one day you're going to cast before his feet anyway. Amen? Amen? Hallelujah. I still have more scriptures that go with this. I didn't bring them with me. Amen? So maybe there'll be a part 3. You want to hear more? Or you want me to bring a message next week on, oh, how sweet you all are? You want to grow spiritually, right? It takes exercise. It takes being a doer of the word, not a hearer only. It takes believing God radically. If God said it, it has to be truth. And if it has to be truth, it has to be truth for you. And if it has to be truth for you, it has to manifest in your life. But it might take more than a day for it to show up, right? All the promises of God are yours. You paid for it at Amazon.com. They're yours. The bank statement showed up as a push notice on your cell phone. You spent $92 on it. It's yours. The bank says it's yours. The bank took your money out and gave it to Amazon. It's yours, but it might take 10 days to show up. Right? I just ordered a part for my car, right? It took about 6 days to come. After the first day, I didn't run out to the mailman and say, is it here? Is it here? No, this Amazon stuff doesn't work. No, I know that there's a waiting process. Every farmer knows that when you plant your seeds in spring, you have to wait for spring, you have to wait for summer, and then fall you pick your crop. There's a time period. Trust God, stand in faith, don't be moved. Amen? You could do it. You could become active. You could become fruitful. Rise out of wishy-washy and be dynamic. Team up with someone and become the dynamic duo. Bang, bam, pop. Amen? That's right, Batman reference. The young people don't know what I'm talking about. Na 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 na. You got it. Amen? Did you receive something this morning? Well, give the Lord a praise. Hallelujah. If you're watching this morning, I got good news for you. Jesus loves you. He wants to see you rise up out of your condition. He wants to set you free from sin and the control of sin. And he wants you to know and experience him and his love. If you've never given your life to Jesus, I got good news for you. It's very simple. It's not about joining a church. It's not about church membership. It's not about denominational membership. It's about asking Jesus to be the Lord and the Savior of your life. All you have to do is invite him into your life. If you believe that Jesus died on a cross, was buried, and rose again, then that's it. That's the qualification. You just have to invite him in and recognize him as that. I'd be willing to pray with you right now. If there's anyone here in the midst of our congregation this morning that has never invited Jesus into your heart, we're going to pray together. We're all going to join in prayer. I'm going to lead you in a prayer. If you just say this prayer and you believe it and you mean it with your heart, God's going to do something in your life. Say, Heavenly Father, I come to you as I am a sinner. Lord Jesus, I acknowledge that you died on a cross and that you were buried and rose again. I ask you now to forgive me of all my sin. I invite you into my heart. Fill me up with your Holy Spirit. Fill me up with a desire for your word, a desire to know you personally. Give me the ear to hear your voice. Bring me into a relationship with you. Thank you for saving me. Thank you for healing me. Thank you for making me your child. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Now, if you prayed that for the first time, come on, bless the Lord. If you prayed that for the first time this morning, I have good news for you. This is a brand new day. What happened yesterday, what happened last week, what happened last year, what happened in the last decade is irrelevant. Every sin that you have ever committed has been forgotten. You've been cleansed. You've been forgiven. It's been forgotten. Now you need to forgive yourself and you need to move forward. You've now been born again spiritually. This is a brand new day. This is the beginning of your new life. If you don't have a Bible, give me a call. I'll be more than happy to send you a Bible and teach you how to begin to walk in this life. If you don't have a home church and you're in the Flushing area, come visit us. We would love to have you. If you're not in the Flushing area and you're looking for a church, email me or call me. I will find you a church in your neighborhood because I love you and I want to see you grow in the things of God. Amen. Thank you for joining us. God bless you. We love you. Amen. See you next week.